Hi, everyone. This is Miriam Naimi from the Alan Turing Institute and Newcastle University. Welcome to our SuperGen Smart Charging webinar series. The webinar is an activity of the Vehicle Grid Integration Group at the Alan Turing Institute. The Turing is the national institute in the UK for data science and artificial intelligence. And one of the objectives of the institute is to apply data science methods to real-world problems, such as what we are doing at the Vehicle Grid Integration Group, where we are helping to decarbonize transport and electricity infrastructure. On the webinar, we had talks already on regional and national infrastructure rollout plans. We also had talks on cybersecurity, and we had talks on communication protocols such as ISO 15118 and OCPP. And in 2 weeks, we're going to have an event on OpenADR, including some talks about flexibility projects in the UK. If you'd like to know more about the webinar and access the previous slides, just search for Smart Charging Webinar and you should, and our landing page should come up. You can also find all the previous videos on our YouTube playlist. I'm delighted today to have a talk on EEBUS, a communication protocol for distributed energy resources. I'd like to know more, what is EEBUS? How does it fit in the overall EV ecosystem? How can it be used for EV charging? And we're going to know more about this today, including a case study of how has it been implemented at Audi. So I'm delighted to welcome Marin Fiege from EEBUS and Gerhard Paris from Audi to tell us more about EEBUS. Marin, Gerhard, over to you.
Yes, thank you very much for the kind introduction, Miriam. I'm going to share my screen now. Okay, you should see the starting slide right now.
We are, yeah.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, so thanks again for the kind introduction, Miriam, and I'm very happy to have the opportunity today to present EEBUS in this illustrious series of webinars. Thank you very much for the invitation, and I'm also very happy that Gerhard Paris from Audi will join me today in talking to you about EV charging with EEBUS. So here's the agenda for today. First of all, I'm going to give an overview on what is EEBUS and who's behind it. And then a short intro on how it works. What do we do and how does the protocol work? And then we're going to go into the e-mobility specific use cases and how Audi uses them in the Audi e-tron. Gerhard is going to take over for that part. And then I'm going to wrap it up at the end and also give some information on the standardization activities that we are doing at EEBUS. So without further ado, what is EEBUS? First of all, EEBUS is a non-profit association called EEBUS Initiative, EV. EV is kind of German denominator for an association. And the association includes 50, 60-ish members from the industry, some of which are direct members, such as the companies shown at the bottom of the screen. So here you see all kinds of companies from industry through metering, energy suppliers, most of them, but not all of them from Germany. Then we have white goods manufacturers such as, Arçelik, Miele, Wizuk, BSH and others, we have HVAC manufacturers such as Daikin, manufacturers of charging infrastructure like Violin, Webasto, Costal, etc. So some of them are listed here, and we also have some German industry associations who are members. First of all, the VDA, that's the German Association of the Automotive Industry. Then related to that, the VDIK, that's the German Association of International Car Manufacturers, as well as BDH, the Federation of German Heating Industry, and VDE is the Association for Electrical, Electronic and Information Technologies in Germany. So a number of manufacturers are also members through these industry associations, such as Audi and the Volkswagen Group, which is why you don't see them under the list of the other companies. The eBus initiative was founded in 2012 with the goal of creating a common non-proprietary language for energy, because the founder saw that the most important prerequisite for holistic energy management is the exchange of information. And on behalf of our members from the industry, and also in close collaboration with them in our eBus working groups, we identify use cases and we specify and standardize the data exchange using our protocols, the spine and chip protocols, about which I'm going to talk in a minute. And we create use cases that provide energy management solutions all around the premises, such as shown here on the slide, capacity management on a building level, time of use, tariffs, increase of self-consumption and auto-curate, energy flexibility, as well as monitoring and comfort functions. And here on the right, you see the EMS in the energy management system in the center of the house. And we basically cover all these devices around it, so like PV systems and inverters, battery systems, HVAC devices, white goods such as a washing machine, as well as electromobility, and we also talk to the grid. So how does it work? How do we work, and what do we offer? Here we see the kind of EBA system architecture. Here on the left, you see the SGAM model, the smart grid application model, with its different layers, from the component layer, communication layer here in green, information function and organizational layer. And with our protocols, ship and spine, and the use cases, we cover these three middle layers here. So at the bottom is the communication layer, which is covered by a protocol, transport protocol called SHIP, which is an acronym for Smart Home IP. This is a protocol that can sit either on TCP or UDP and transports messages in the communication layer. Then on top of that, but also independent from it, there's the spine protocol. Spine covers the information layer of SGAM. And again, an acronym, it stands for Smart Premises Interoperable Neutral Message Exchange. And it specifies both header information, we call it spine protocol, as well as the actual payload data, which we call the spine resources. And on top of all of that, we cover the functional layer by creating use case specifications. So when we take a little closer look, starting at the bottom at the communication layer, here we have again the SGAM model on the left and the corresponding OSI layers. excuse me. So SHIP is kind of the transport protocol that we use on top of either UDP or TCP, and it is independent from the spine protocol, so you could also transport other payloads with it. The benefit of SHIP though is that it already has a number of comprehensive security features such as mutual authentication, pairing, establishing trust levels, and other cybersecurity measures. It uses TLS 1.2 for encryption, and its security level conforms to the German security regulations by the German BSI, which is not the British Standardization Institute, but the German Federal Bureau for Information Technology Security, who have made some strict requirements there. And as we have also been somewhat involved with the British PAS 1878, we think that it should also fulfill the requirements of these upcoming standards in the UK. But as the requirements are still being formulated, we will see. Okay, then the information layer is covered by spine, smart premise, interoperable, neutral message exchange, and that is the layer that describes the data models needed for the technical implementation of the use cases. Spine is an international standard. It has been so since, I think, 2017 when it was first standardized, and it's being updated and re-standardized since then. Can be transmitted in TCP/IP and UDP environments. Of course, in the TCP/IP environment, the protocol of choice would be, but does not have to be SHIP. Spine data structures are specified in as XML schema definitions, so you can send spine messages as XML, but as we have seen in many cases, implementations use JSON messages, and that works just fine. Okay, a little quick dip into the data model. Don't want to go too deep, but at least give you an impression of what it looks like. So the spine messages that we send around are called datagrams. And such a datagram consists of a header and a payload. How these are look like is specified in the spine protocol specification. The header contains address information, command classifiers. So that means is the message I'm sending, is it a notification? Is it a write message? Is it a read message, or what is it? And some other things. And the important part here is the address destination, because in EBUS, in Spine, we have this model of devices that can have one or more entities underneath them, and for each entity there's one or more features that are used. On the other hand, we have the payload that has some background information, for example filters, if you want to target a specific message or a specific piece of data, some other information. The important part again here is the functions. And so we have different functions in Spine that can do different things. And these functions are built up from elements. And how does it all fit together? Here on the right, you see our resource model. So again, you see here the triad, the devices, entities, and features nested into each other. What devices can we use in a specific use case can be restricted by the so-called device type that we define. So a device type, for example, could be a fridge freezer. In this device, there can be multiple entities. So in a fridge freezer, it could be a fridge part and the freezer part. These would be different entities. And the fridge could have different features. And again, the types that we specify kind of restrict the options that you have in a specific use case. A feature type could be an actuator, switch, or a number of other things. And the feature types, again, they have functions associated with them, and the functions contain different elements. I think you will see some examples later on also in Gerhard's part of the presentation. Okay, and with all these data and resource models that we have defined in Spine, we now have a kind of a toolbox that is very flexible, and we can pick and choose now from the parts of the protocol specification, all the different device and entity types, etc., as well as all the functions and elements in the resource specification, and pick and choose and combine them as needed for a specific use case defined in our working groups, and put together a use case specification that an implementer can then take and use it as a very precise guideline for implementation. And for another use case, then you would perhaps use other elements from the toolbox, but the basic set of tools and functions still stays the same. And so, this is what we basically do. We have, I think, 5 working groups on the topics of e-mobility and inverters, of course, one on HVAC, one for white goods, so one for grid communication, and then we have some overarching working groups on product management and on connectivity and cloud. And in these groups, members define a high-level use case together with our engineers. The high-level use case is then split into scenarios, and we first define everything on a rather high level, and then we have a part in the document that gives you the implementation guide for each of the scenarios. So a scenario could be basically a logical step in the use case, and for each of these steps we have all the Spine resources and how to apply them to the specific use case. And then in the end, in the appendix or in the annex of the document, you have some concrete XML examples, so you can see what your messages could or should look like. And in this way, we then build all these different solutions, as I said, for all the different devices and how they interact with each other, how they play together. If you're interested in some more, all the specifications that I was talking about, as well as the many of the use cases that we have created together with our members, are available on our website, eebus.org, under downloads and specifications. I have the URL here on the side, and maybe if Gerd could be so kind, then we can also share it in the in the chat. So these are free. The eebus is also free to, or license free to use. The only thing you have to do to download the information is you have to register once, but again, that is also free of charge. The only thing that costs money is if you want to say, yeah, I want to participate in EBUS and I want to shape how the use cases, which use cases are created and how they are made, then you have to become a member. Okay, so as I said, we have use cases for many different things, but as this is an EV charging webinar, we are going to focus on the e-mobility related use cases right now. So before Gerhard takes over, let me just quickly show how EBUS is embedded in the landscape. So you can use EBUS for electromobility, both in the local and in the cloud environment. And in the local environment, we have the electric vehicle or the EV here on the right, and we assume that it talks to the charging equipment, we call it the EVSE, through ISO 15118. we have implemented Dash 2, and we are closely following the development of the Dash 20, and we'll support that also. Or you can also use pulse width modulation according to IEC 61851. Or other protocols can be used as well, and the map such as CHAdeMO. And the mapping to EBUS is then done in the charging station, and the charging station will talk EBUS to the energy management system, and the EMS will also talk EBUS to other components in your on your premises, such as PV panel, for example, and the EMS will also talk to the grid through EBUS or other standards such as IEC 61850. Many electric vehicles come with a manufacturer or OEM backend. An EMS can also have a backend component in the cloud, and we're currently also working on cloud version of EBUS that would allow cloud-to-cloud communication in the backend. The automotive industry, as I mentioned earlier, is involved in and linked to EBUS through the industry associations VDA and VDIK. We have many working group members in EBUS who are from the automotive industry. Some brands are also considering to join EBUS directly, and very prominently, Audi has already released a vehicle supporting EBUS, the e-tron, about which we will hear a lot of interesting things in a minute. The entire Volkswagen group sets on EBUS, so that also includes Volkswagen and Porsche. And what is that? BMW is also using and testing EBUS in a bidirectional charging project in Germany called BDL. There have been other integration projects in the past also using and testing EV communication with the EBUS, and recently an international manufacturer, namely Honda, also joined EBUS. So, without further ado, I'm now handing over to Gerhard, and he will now talk to you about how Audi's smart charging features are realized with the EBUS protocol. Gerhard, if you please.
So, thank you, Maren.
Okay, I'm going to end my sharing.
My screen. So. So I hope you can see the right screen.
Yes.
Perfect. So thank you, Maren, for your introduction. As Maren mentioned, we at Audi, we have launched our first BEV project. So it's a only battery electrical vehicle without a combustion engine. And this electric vehicle is on the market, I think, around about 1 or 2 years ago. And now you can buy the charging system Connect with the car. You see it here. It's a charging system. You can plug on the wall. And in the charging system included with the car offers our intelligent charging functions. So it's a function set of different functions. You have, for example, charging optimization functions that are optimizing your EV charging. And then you have charging equipment functions that are functions that are based on the charging equipment itself. So for example, you have a very simple charging feature. You can put a departure time into the car and then the car is charging to the target state of charge. It's called the SOZ until that departure time. Then you always have the battery as full as you want to that certain time you want. Then we have a feature, it's called blackout protection, that helps that if you have a quite small fuse in your grid connection point, that helps to save the fuse from tripping during charging. Then we have dynamic PV optimized charging. So that speaks for itself. There you can charge your self-produced PV power directly into the car. And in addition, we have cost-optimized charging. So there you can put your tariff, for example, your energy tariff into for the first function here into the EMS. It's an energy management system you have installed in a house. And then the whole system with the car and the charging station allows to charge only to the cheapest tariff times. Then we almost have the same functionality with our own backend, with our my Audi. There you can put a tariff data as well into it, and then the car charges concerning this tariff data. And we have as well in our My Audi application, a remote control and a visualization included. So you can start, stop charging, and you see with how, you see with what power the car is charging at the moment and how long it will need to reach the wished charging, the SOC, the wished charging state. Then we have some charging equipment functions. So it's the most important functionality is that the car can be charged with 22 kilowatt hours. Then another functionality is that you can see in one hand the charging plan during the charging. So you see when the car planned to charge with what power. And then later on, after the charging session is finished, you get a charging statistic where you see different information about the charging session. But I tell later more information about that. And then for sure, you have a PIN identification on the EVSE that no one else can charge instead of you. And it's possible that you have a plug and charge on the charging system as well. So with the Audi e-tron and our charging system Connect, you have plug and charge as well at home. So plug and charge means you plug the car and you don't have to put any pin into the charging station. So it identifies itself over certificates. And then last but not least, you have the online update. So the EVSE or the charging station can be updated remotely. Here you can see the orange marked functions. This means for these functions, we need the EBS protocol. So at first, I want to tell you a bit about the topology. I mentioned before, you have here the Audi e-tron you need, and the e-tron has to be connected to our charging system connect. The charging system connect has two interfaces. It has one power line interface and a Wi-Fi interface. And with these two, you can connect to your home Wi-Fi, maybe over a Fritzbox or another router. And in your home network, you should have a home energy management system. So we have here two cooperational partners. It's SMR Solar Technology and the Hager Group. That are two German and German-French producers of electric installation material, and they produce as well energy management systems. And over this communication line, the car is able to speak with the energy management systems, and the EVSE is in between and does the mapping. So you see here, over the physical layer, you see the protocols. We speak here to the car, the ISO 15118, as Mark Mültin as well explained in another webinar. And from the EVSE to the EMS, we speak the EVAS protocol. So to the car, we need the ISO 15118. It's not possible to have the normal IEC 51861 because it's just with PWM communication and it's not enough to communicate all the necessary data. And then we have on our own backend, as I explained before, the My Audi Cloud. And there you can see the charging statistics and the remote control, for example. And this is connected to the car over mobile radiation and to the charging station over the home network as well. So because I mentioned the we have to be connected to the EMS, so the EMS or HEMS, it's the home energy management system, is a very important part of our whole system and of the functionality. So because the EMS knows all data of the house, so it's one of the two brains of our functions. One brain is in the car for the charge planning, and the other brain is in the house in the EMS. The EMS knows, for example, PV forecast, that tells the EMS how many power when will be produced from the PV plant on the roof, for example. The EMS knows the baseload prognose forecast of the other loads in the household. Then it can speak, for example, with the grid. If you have less grid power available, then it can be sent to the EMS as well from the grid. And it knows the energy tariff. So the EMS has the possibility to mix up all these information and send it to the car. But more to that mechanism, I tell you later. So at first, as I mentioned before, we have here the functions we want to sell and provide to the customers. And we have here the EBUS use cases. As Maren said before, there are a few working groups in the EBUS. This working group is the e-mobility working group. And here you have a use case set. Here it are, I think, 8 use cases. And with these use cases, you can build or implement a certain functionality. For example, here, for our functions, as I mentioned before, you need these use cases to implement the functionality we want offer to the customer. And you see, you need some use cases twice or even more time. And here the FAT marked use case is that main use case where the main functionality can be implemented. And the other use cases are needed to have our whole functionality, what we understand under this function. So I'll start and tell a bit about our four functions and the EEBUS use cases that are behind. So let's start with one of the more easier functions. It's the overload protection use case. As I mentioned before, the overload protection use case is there to limit the charging power in case of an overload in the grid connection point in the house. So maybe you have some other huge house loads, for example, an oven or a sauna, then maybe the power consumption is too big for the fuse and the grid connection point, and then the fuse will trip and you will have a local blackout in your home. And that this doesn't occur, we have this feature, and with this feature, the blackout is prevented and the charging current gets reduced. So you see it here. You have the car, the charging system connect, the EMS, and a current sensor at the grid connection point. So this means the current sensor at the grid connection point all the time monitors the drawn power from the grid and sends it to the EMS. The EMS itself knows what's the nominal current of the fuses at the grid connection point. And it knows as well the charging current from the car, because the EVSE has a energy meter inside as well, and all the time sends the current charging current to the EMS. Then the EMS gets noticed when the charging current on the grid connection point is too high, it's more than the nominal current of the fuse, then it sends current limits to the EVSE. It's here called Emax, and the EVSE maps these current values from the EEBUS nomenclature to the ISO protocol. You see here in the ISO protocol, we use the ISO 15118-2. That's released in 2013 or 14, so it's quite common. And we send in the EVSE max current this limited current to the car, and the car limits its charging power concerning this set point. Or even if the overload is over or is not that high again, they send a maximum current that's adopted to the car, and then the car adopts its charging current as well. So it can be decreased decreased or increased. And to get notice if the EMS gets lost because of a connection loss or something like that, there is a heartbeat signal over the EEBUS sent from the EMS to the EVSE. And if this heartbeat signal has a timeout after 4 seconds, the EVSE gets in a safe state so that there can't occur any overload. So the next functionality we provide to our customers is the optimization of self-consumption. So we have here directional self-consumption control, let's say. Yeah, you have here again the energy meter at the grid connection point that measures on one hand the power that is drawn from the grid and sent into the house or the car. But if you have a photovoltaic production, the meter as well measures if you feed the photovoltaic overproduction back into the grid. And this this feed-in current is sent to the EMS. The EMS takes this current again, adds it to the current charging current, and sends it to the EVSE. And then the EVSE takes it, sends it to the car, and the car can increase or decrease if there is a cloud or something like that on the sky, and then charges with the optimum of self-produced power. So you see, it's quite the same as the overload protection mechanism. So you can use a lot of the data from the eBus use cases you had for the overload protection for this use case. So the next very interesting use case, but a bit, let's say, tricky use case is the coordinated EV charging. The coordinated EV charging sends, as I told before, all the information the EMS has, the information over the maximum available power or the information of the tariffs to the car, so that the car can do a very good charge planning. And with this charge plan, it's sent back to the EMS, and the EMS then knows when the car will charge. So that means at the beginning, the car sends its demands to the EMS. The EMS sends these tables with PMAX and the sales tariff back to the car, and then the car sends its charging plan back to the EMS. So here there are some screens from our e-tron, from the multimedia interface of the e-tron. You see here, you can set a departure time. I'm sorry for it's in German, but you see here it's Friday, 7 p.m. And you can here in the screen below set a target SOC. So here it's 100%. And then you activate the timer. Then this this information is sent to the EVSE. It's the departure time and the needed energy to reach the target SOC. It's called in the ISO nomenclature E amount and departure time. You see here, it's sent in the signal flow charge parameter discovery request to the EVSE. The EVSE maps this information to the EEBUS message. It's called AC energy signal demand in this case, and sends it to the EMS. Then the EMS takes these values in addition to the tariff and PMAX values it has from its different sources, and creates out of them a maximum power table. The maximum power table is a table over time where you have some maximum power slots. That includes, for example, you have started from now 1 hour, for example, 11 kilowatts available. Then in the next slot, it's a bit less, and so on and so on until the departure time is reached. And the EMS sends the tariff information to the car as well. The tariff information you see here, it's a tariff table. You can have different energy costs, because, for example, you have a tariff with a lot of different a lot of different costs over time, let's say. Yeah, maybe a day-night tariff, but in some countries there are even more tariffs that differ from hour to hour, maybe. Or you have, as in Germany, for example, a feed-in tariff that means when you feed in from your PV power plant, then you get a bit of money, and that means that the power you take from the photovoltaic on your rooftop is cheaper than you take it from the grid, for example. And this different energy structure is here signed in the tariff table. And the tariff table is then sent as well over the EE bus, you see it here, to the EVSE. And the EVSE does again the mapping to the maximum power, and the sales tariff table sends it to the car. Then the car is able to create a charge plan. You see it like here, or here you see a photovoltaic curve, for example, over the day. Here you have midday, it's very big. And then it's sent back over the EVSE to the EMS, and the EMS so can plan the energy that it doesn't provide it for other loads in the house. And then we have the EV charging summary. Yeah, it's it does that what it's called. So you have the charging history out of the charging summary. Here you see the different message types. I won't go into deep, but here you can see how many of the charge power you have here, the charge power in total, and here how many of the charge power you got from the PV on your rooftop. You see here the costs, and here the charging power over time, what was charged into the car. And this you have on the My Audi application, for example. And then at the end, why we use the EBUS protocol. So there are a lot of there are a lot of reasons why we use it. One of the main reasons I have listed here. So we have a lot of members in the EE bus that come from different domains. You have, as Maren told before, all energy needing domains in the household here together. Yeah, so you don't have to implement a lot of different protocols in the EVSE. That is a lot of effort for implementing, and later on for customer care and for updating them. So you have one protocol, and this one protocol fits over all domains, and you can control all the different loads in the house. It's an IP-based protocol that's very important, and it has TLS authentication. So that's really important for us as well. And what's important too is that the installation is plug and play. So you don't need an installer to install the charging system to the EMS. It even can be done by the end customer itself. So it's very easy. And the EEBUS itself is an open interface. So everyone, as Martin told before, can download the specifications and can implement it. And it has a big focus on interoperability to the different other devices and to the different domains in the house. Yeah, and at least the goal to get an international standard is quite important for us too. So that we have, that would be the best for us, one protocol over the whole world. So this will be the final end for us, the final goal. Yeah, and with that, back to Maren.
Yeah, thank you, Gerhard. Of course, we dream that everybody will use EEBUS all over the world. Okay, I'll try and share my screen. But it's taking a moment. I have seen that there were some questions in the chat, and I think we will have some time at the end to take care of them. Well, unfortunately, I hope you can still hear me.
We can hear you, but
yes. Okay, yeah, I'm having a bit of a technical problem here with sharing my screen. My browser just hung itself. That's not good.
That's fine. Maybe meanwhile, I take some of the questions that were specifically to Gerhard, if that's okay.
Yeah, go ahead, please. And I will see if
Excellent.
I can revive my browser.
So one of the questions, Gerhard, was you've mentioned you're working with ISO 15118 and EEBUS. Are you aware if EEBUS has some use cases with CHAdeMO between the car and the charger? I mean, maybe this is not a question to you, maybe it's a question to Maren, but that was a question on the car side.
Yes, we are aware that CHAdeMO has some use cases as well. For example, even you can do bidirectional charging as well. Yeah, but CHAdeMO is, let's say, a Japanese standard. So the European standard, or not only European, it should be even a standard for the whole world, is the CCS. And so you have the ISO 15118. And because of that, we use for communication between the charging system and the car, the CCS standard, so the ISO 15118. And the CHAdeMO would be even the standard between car and EVSE as well. And so you can have the EBUS in the EVSE again. And maybe it can work.
Yeah.
Maybe it will work with EEBUS as well, but there are no use cases, as far as I know, in special for CHAdeMO.
Okay, and from my understanding, is it correct that EEBUS is a protocol between the charging and an energy management system, whether that's a home or a building?
Yes.
Not only. So unfortunately, it looks like my browser has crashed and I cannot see what you're sharing. But if Gerhard can maybe just hop through the slides real quick. Just back to the CHAdeMO question really quickly on slide 13. Gerhard, could you bring that up, please?
Yeah,
I just don't want to... Yeah, I just don't want to end the browser session, because then I will be totally kicked out.
Yes, maybe you can sign in again.
Yeah, let's try it like this. As Gerhard correctly said, there are no specific CHAdeMO use cases, but you would be able to use CHAdeMO between the car and the charger. The EBUS protocol can be used between the charging station and the EMS, but not only. As you see on slide 13 as well, the EBUS protocol can also be used between other devices, such as a PV panel and the EMS, or between an EMS and a washing machine, or the EMS and a heat pump, what have you. And also, EEBUS can be used to talk to, for example, a DSO or an external service provider. I will have a couple of more slides on that in a bit.
Okay, so should we wait for that? Because one of the questions was, would EEBUS work with OCPP, or does it replace OCPP in certain the home installation?
Yeah, in the home it could do both, but you could also have an EVSE talking OCPP to a back end, like a charging station operator, while you have EEBUS in the house talking to the EMS.
So you'd need that. So you'd need the OCPP to talk to an external operator.
That depends. Right now, as far as I know, I'm not super familiar with OCPP, I have to admit. There are scenarios that are good for OCPP, and there are also scenarios that are good for EBUS. In some scenarios, EBUS can replace other protocols. In other scenarios, it can also work together with other protocols.
For example, the e-bus is even more for the private charging at home, and OCPP is more for the public charging, where you have metering and a tariff with billing and so on.
So just to resume on that point before we move to the slides, I want to understand, are we able to use EE bus between a home and an operator? So if I have an aggregator who wants to help control the energy demand of my house, what is the communication protocol that that aggregator would need to use to control and communicate with my home energy management system?
You mean in the cloud? Well, they could even use EBUS also via WebSockets, for example. So you could use EBUS across the boundary of the premises.
Okay. And how are your slides? Are you able to share again?
Gerd, are you still sharing?
Yeah, I'm sharing. What slide do you want?
30. Can I just ask you to? Oh no, 31. Can I just ask you to go through in my stead? Then we don't have to interrupt. That would be great. Okay. Thank you. And sorry for the technical problems here. I don't know what is going on. Gerhard showed you the majority of the e-bus use cases for AV charging, but those were all unidirectional. It was all about charging the car, but there are also some activities ongoing to not only charge the car, but go bidirectional and also discharge the car for the benefit of some other consumer on the premises. And I'm personally also active in a group that is working out some use cases for bidirectional charging and discharging in Germany. And there we are taking a close look also at the upcoming ISO 15118-20. And we are currently at EBUS in the e-mobility working group. We are working on the first EBUS's first bidirectional EV charging use case for increase of self-consumption. And so the idea is that the car and the charging station would speak ISO 15118-20. And then the charging station, again, would talk EBUS to the EMS, and there would also be a photovoltaic panel speaking EBUS to the EMS. And whenever you have surplus photovoltaic energy that you're not using in the house and that you maybe do not want to feed into the grid because it's maybe you don't get a good price for it, or at least in Germany, it's the case that you cannot feed all of your self-produced PV energy into the grid, but there's always a limit of, 70-80% only that you can feed in. Then you can store the excess energy in your car. And then at a later point in time, maybe when there's an increased need for energy in your house or the sun is not shining because it's after sunset or it's cloudy, then you can take the energy from your car battery and use it in the house. And that is one of the first use cases for bidirectional charging that we're going to release, make available at the end of the year for the dynamic mode in 15118-20, and the scheduled mode will follow. Next slide, please, Gerhard. Okay, and last but not least, I wanted to talk about our standardization activities, because as I said earlier, EBUS has been and is being standardized. Next slide, please. Okay. So I said earlier on in this webinar that eBus has been standardized already in 2017 as part of EN 50631-1, which is a standard about white goods, energy management in white goods. And we are currently in the process with me personally involved and other EBUS members to create a new version of this European standard as part of CENELEC Technical Committee 59X Working Group 7 to talk about how energy management with EBUS can be done with white goods appliances, washing machines, freezers, dishwashers, and such, as well as in the field of HVAC. So HVAC has kind of found a home in that working group as well, and we are going to add use cases for use in the HVAC field, and we're also going to standardize spine and ship on a European level. The final voting for that standard for the new version is planned for July next year, and that will eventually also go on the IEC level. Yeah, then we have been quite busy in Germany. So the next arrow that you see there, VDE AR 2122, that is also a so far a German standard that is that deals with e-mobility. There we are specifying communication using EBUS between the local charging station management system, so the local charging infrastructure, and the local energy management system. This is currently a standard on becoming a standard on the German level. It will come out for public commenting even this year in a few weeks. And it is closely aligned also with the work of IEC TC 69 and the work that is being done on the 63110. And we want to make that an IEC standard as well. Next arrow, FNN is a also a German association for grid control under the VDE. And they are specifying a so-called Steuerbox or control box for the grid connection point. And in the past, this control box has been using for relay contacts. So you could turn individual loads on and off, and that is being digitized as we speak. And it will also use EEBUS to, so the distribution system operator could now control loads on your in your premises using EEBUS. I'm going to have another slide on that later. So the first use case that is being realized there with this control box and also in the standard that is in the next arrow, the 2829. The EDSO can impose an active power limitation. There's some legislation in Germany around that being written also as we speak. So for a limited time, you can your energy supplier can limit the amount, maximum active power that you can use or consume in your household in exchange for financial compensation. And that is being standardized also right now. So the requirements for the control box are being finalized right now. And the standard 2829-6 is currently in public commenting phase and will hopefully then be finalized early next year. Then the second to last arrow, PIS 1878, I think people in the UK will probably have heard about it. that is a British standard around energy smart appliances and how a DSRSP, a demand side response service provider on the grid side, can control these energy smart appliances. We have also been in close contact with the UK BSI, and this PAS mentions two possible protocols that excuse me, that could be used to implement this PAS, and one of them is EEBUS. So we are in close contact with these people as well to be able to apply EEBUS to that case. And as I said earlier, we're also active in a group in Germany that works out use cases for bidirectional charging and how the communication could look like. And we are there not writing a standard ourselves, but we are providing input for other standards such as 15118-20 or 63110. Okay, next slide, please, Gerhard. Yeah, I mentioned this earlier. This this is to illustrate the mechanism with the control box. So that is a very recent success story of EEBUS. This orange shaded box with the dashed line around it at the boundary of the premises, that in Germany could be a smart meter with a smart meter gateway and a control box that provides communication lines into and out of the house for energy related communication, and an external market participant could such as the DSO could provide information on power limitations to the premises through that control box and smart meter gateway to a controllable system, which could be a local energy management system or any smart appliance that is controllable. And that is based on EEBUS. And we are going to follow the initial publication with an extended version where we would also then offer the ability to provide flexible tariffs to the house or incentives for optimizing the consumption. For those familiar with the situation in Germany, there's currently legislation called paragraph 14A of the energy economy regulation being worked on that that provides the basis for DSOs to be able to impose power limits in exchange for reduced power transfer fees. Okay, and I think I have one more slide, Gerhard, if you please. Yeah, just to wrap up the part on standardization, basically, now with all the standardization activities, EEBUS can cover all the connections in the house and outside by a standard that involves EEBUS. So again, on the left, we have the grid side with external market participants and DSOs talking to the EMS through the standard I just mentioned on the last slide, and also the PAS 18778 would also fall into that category. Inside the house, we can talk to inverters and batteries, also using the same standard. Then for white goods and HVAC, we have the EN50631 standard. And for the communication between the EMS and the charging equipment, we would have the standard 2122 in alignment with ISO 15118 and IEC 63110. So this, I think, in a nutshell, provides all the areas where EBUS could be used. We're also active in the development of the SARIF ontology with this, which is a energy-related ontology framework. And we're also active in other standardization groups for standards around energy management systems, such as EN 50491. So with that, I would like to thank you very much for attending our webinar and for your interest in the EBUS. And if you have any further questions, then I think Gerhard and I will be happy to take them now. If you would like to receive further information, then please check out our website at www.eebus.org.
Great. Thank you, Marin. Thank you, Gerhard. We have a couple of questions left. Sure. Do you have any use cases where EEBUS is used directly with smart meters?
We do. We have a use case monitoring of grid connection point where the EMS can basically read out the metering values from the smart meter on the grid connection point.
On that last slide, and back to that previous discussion we had, did you show EEBUS connecting an EMS to a DSO?
Yes.
So you cannot point. Okay.
No, I cannot point, unfortunately. I mean, I can. If you go back to which one is it? I think that's too bad.
Yeah, that's
technical. I'm totally blind here. The slide with the house and the magnifier, Gerhard, should be
slide 34.
Yeah, if you say so.
So you have here, for example, the smart meter gateway, and yep. There you have two use cases from the EEBUS you can implement, and that you can talk to the DSO. So it's one, it's a monitoring use case so that you can monitor the grid connection point at least. And the other one is the so-called LPC. It's a use case where you can send the power limitation from a grid operator directly to the smart meter gateway and then to an EMS, for example.
Yeah, excellent. Why was I in this webinar anyway? You could have done it yourself, Gerhard.
Thank you.
No, that's totally correct. So any energy market participant, and the DSO is only the first of them, they could impose power limits on households through EEBUS. And moving forward, we're also working on in projects where energy suppliers will provide flexible tariffs to homes, and that could also be done through the EEBUS protocol with this mechanism, possibly a mechanism similar to the incentive tables that Gerhard showed earlier.
Are you able to comment briefly on the security measures implemented by EEBUS?
Most of these are in the SHIP protocol. I think I showed this on it was on slide 7. There was not much to see on there. So SHIP is based on TLS 1.2 in its latest installment, and TLS 1.2 has the latest security mechanisms, so the encryption algorithms, brain pool, and what was the other one? But these encryption protocols are supported. We also have a mechanism. So when two ship devices want to talk to each other, they first have to establish the connection. So they have to discover each other, and then they have to create a binding. And during that process, they exchange information also on different trust levels, a user trust level and device trust levels and others. And depending on how you establish this connection, different security measures are in place. So there are mechanisms where, for example, you have a key on a sticker on the device itself that you scan or enter into an app. That is a more secure mechanism. The least secure mechanism would be to just allow the device to say, yeah, whatever, connect to me. But then you would be restricted in functionality. And recently we also have created a way through a so-called commissioning tool that allows you to establish a secure trust level between devices when you first connect them.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions related to, but maybe this is quickly related to the last point. Why not TLS 1.3?
To my knowledge, TLS 1.3 is not fully defined yet, but it will certainly follow. Right now, the standard, at least in Germany, through the German BSI regulations, is at least 1.2.
Okay.
But we're moving forward as the technology moves forward. So I'm sure TLS 1.3 will also come.
Thank you. Considering we're running out of time, I'm going to take two more questions, and I apologize for the rest of the participants who I was not able to take their questions. Can I encourage them to contact you maybe directly with the questions?
Yes, sure.
Okay. So the last two questions first, these are for Audi. Do you have any plans for the car to allow bi-directional charging? Are you planning to implement ISO 15118-20?
For Audi, bidirectional charging is a topic, yes, for sure. And at the moment, it's a bit tricky because the ISO standard isn't released yet. But if we bring bidirectional charging, it will be with ISO 15118. So another standard or a proprietary standard even comes not in mind for us. Maybe if you have seen, 2 or 3 months ago, we had a press release where we showed a prototype testing with an E3 DC storage system and an Audi e-tron that showed bidirectional charging with not directly an ISO 15118-20 protocol, but with a mix with the proprietary development, because as you mentioned, the protocol is not finished yet, but it's a big
topic. Nothing stopping it from. Yeah, excellent. Okay, last question is, do you see a case where you can control the car directly instead of going through a charger?
It may be the case if it's it provides a benefit for the customer, even a benefit from a money saving point of view, or a functional benefit, it could be possible in future implementations or in future cars. So at least the EIBA standard would be a basis for this as well. So from the standard side, it would be possible
to control the car directly through.
Exactly. So that, as you have seen, the EVSE in this part is more or less just a gateway functionality. It would be, you can think about it to leave that away and just have, let's say, a dumb PWM EVSE, and you do the smart communication directly to the car. So it has pros and cons for sure.
Okay, thank you. Gerard, Maren, thank you so much for your time. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, thank you very much for having us. And I'm Miriam, maybe if you would like to share at least my email address, Gerd, if he wants to, then people can contact me directly
with any further questions,
follow-ups.
Follow-ups, yes. Maybe could you enter it in the chat box?
Unfortunately, I cannot because my browser has crashed. But maybe Gerhard can. It's fee@eebus.org.
Oh, yes, okay. All right. Well, thank you so much again. And we will make the recording available on YouTube. Goodbye.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, too. Thank you for listening. Bye.
Bye.